Hi guys, this is Ryu from ryuri.com and welcome to my next Photoshop tutorial. Today I have a really cool stuff for you guys. I'm going to show you how to create a time lapse in Photoshop, and this tutorial will be split into part 1 and part 2. In part 1 I will show you how to prepare the photos for the time lapse, and in part 2 I actually show you how to put them together to make it into a movie. Now, what is time lapse? For those of you who don't know, time lapse is basically a sequence of photos played at a faster speed to create an illusion of a movie. And I created a time lapse, two time lapses yesterday. Well, actually I shot photos for two time lapses at Tokyo Station, that you can see the Tokyo Station on the right side, and this is the place in front of Tokyo Station, and here is a short time lapse that I just finished creating, putting it together. And I have another one shot to the right side on the rail tracks and in all those passing trains, Shinkansens, etc., and I want to put it together and create a new one. So anyway, that was really fast, but you can, in this time lapse, you can see 430 photos almost, and within a few seconds. So that's how fast you can view 430 photos. So time lapse is really fun, but it requires a few things to do. Now, the first thing, of course, is you'll need a tripod, and you'll need something that is called intervalometer, I think it's called. It's a horrible word. I mean, it's a device that actually allows you to set an intervals between the shots and duration of exposure, you know, various things. And basically you just press it and it's automatically releases a trigger, the shutter in your camera. It looks like the remote control for a cable, remote control for a camera. And you know, they're really cheap, so you can get them for like $20 or something, and it's a lot of fun. So anyway, you will need that, and you'll need a really, really sturdy tripod, because any movement in your photos, it will show a lot of shaking. So you need to think about that. Okay, so I'm in bridge, and bridge is probably the best way to go to preview and select your photos for your time lapse, and there are a few reasons for it. One is because it's really convenient, and two, that you can rename all the photos and assign numbers to them at the same time. You can see already that my files are renamed. These are RAW files, but they have different names, so it's not a default camera name, but a default name. And when you shoot time lapse photography, you'll be taking a lot of photographs, thousands of exposures, and the camera naming resets every 10,000 files. So you'll end up having the same names of files in your computer, and it might be confusing. So it's really easy to rename them. Another thing is that you need to have a sequence of photos, so the photos have to be named and numbers need to be added that actually are sequential. So, you know, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and not like 1, 7, 8. Because then Photoshop or whatever program you're using, for example, Adobe After Effects, will add, you know, blank spaces or some black spaces or some weird stuff, and this will not look good. So first of all, how can you review the files? Well, basically when you click on a photo and press a space, this will display a photo at full screen, and when you press space, it's gonna return. But when you press a space and then, for example, click on it, it will basically zoom into the photo, and then you can press a space and go back. So space, click, and then you can, you know, sort of pan with a mouse and check if everything is sharp. And then now you can, you know, check all the photos. When all the photos are checked, what you want to do is press Ctrl A. I'm just going to deselect this folder here, and this will select all the photos, and you go to Tools and click on Batch Rename. As I said, I've already done that, so I'm not going to be doing that. But what you want to do in here is to leave this possibly at default, and in a new file name, choose text and type your text. I'm using underscores for that. Also, make sure that you're going to input an underscore in here, so it's going to be easy to actually see the numbers. And then in the number area, put whichever number you want. I'm starting usually zero. The number 342 that you can see here is caused by the fact that there are 342 photos in this sequence, and that's 341 photos. And Photoshop actually automatically, not Photoshop, Bridge automatically assigns the same name to the file and gives the sequential number. So if you had 341 photos in a first batch, the second batch will start from number 342. So you know you can change it to zero. And then this is important, choosing how many digits the number must have. Well, in this case is 4. If you have more than 1000 photos, choose 5. And that's about it. And then you click on rename. I'm not going to click on rename because I've already done that, so I'm gonna leave it alone. And then once you do that, you right click on a file. All of those files should be selected, and then just click on open in camera raw. Well, now the fun begins. So now we're in camera raw, and let me resize this here so you can actually see that. There we go. And you can now either select all photos or just work on the first photo for, at the moment, depending on how fast your computer is. I'm gonna select all 340 photos because you know my computer is pretty fast, so it doesn't really matter. Now I'm going to work on some adjustments. Already I can see that I should have actually shot it wider. I couldn't shoot it wider because I was actually shooting at 10 millimeters, so it was the widest I could get. But I think I composed it badly because I should have cropped those buildings on the top here and get a bit more of the street. But I think, I can't remember now, but I think if I was going wider, I was getting some rooftops in here. But the point is that when you actually gonna put this into a movie mode, like for YouTube, the view is slightly wider than, I think it's 16:9, and this one is 3:4, I think, so for 4:3. So it's gonna basically, it's gonna basically create, I'm gonna grab a crop tool, it's gonna create, an image of more or less those proportions. So it is good to actually bear that in mind. I was composing it for a regular photo, possibly thinking to cropping the top. I just forgot that in a time lapse the ratio will change, so I didn't take this into consideration. But anyway, this is not a big deal. So first thing I'm gonna do, I'm going to work on a white balance. I'll show the daytime white balance, which is okay. I'm going to maybe make it a little bit colder. Just a little bit colder, yeah, maybe it's too cold. Something like that. And increase vibrance, yeah. Increase vibrance, I'm gonna boost clarity. I can actually boost clarity quite a bit. And increase some contrast. I'm going to open the shadows and maybe lift the blacks a bit. Yeah, something like this. So I can actually see those railways. This is the advantage of shooting in RAW, as opposed to JPEGs, that you have a lot of flexibility with the file. Now I'm going to reduce the shadows in here and perhaps increase the contrast just a bit, to introduce a bit more vignetting on top and possibly in the bottom, so this middle section is more open. I'm gonna grab a new brush and do the opposite. So basically open the shadows. Maybe brush is a little bit too big. Open the shadows here in the bottom and maybe reduce the contrast a bit. And now I'm going to grab another brush and drop the highlights, reduce the size of my brush, maybe drop the highlights a bit more, and you know, just sort of extinguish some of those lights here that are slightly too bright for my liking. Make it a bit darker, you know, something like that. And grab a new brush, make it even smaller. You don't have to be, you know, really precise with it because it's a time lapse. Those photos will be played so fast that it's not really that crucial to be, you know, that detailed. Okay, that will do, I think. Maybe it's a bit too much. There we go. Okay, I'm gonna go back here, maybe drop some whites a little bit. Yeah. Okay. If you press Alt, you can actually see the overexposed areas. So, press Alt and hold your mouse key pressed. Yeah, on it works in shadows, whites, and blacks. Okay, yeah, and highlights too, same thing. And I'm going to correct the lens distortion. That's quite important. Remember about that. Chromatic aberrations, I don't think so really. Maybe purples. Well, yeah, why not? Let's remove them. The lens distortion, make sure that, you know, you choose the lens you are using, your maker. In my case, it's Sigma 10-20 3.5 lens. And now I'm actually thinking about correcting this perspective, you know, manually. So just you know, maybe lift that photo a bit, and I don't know. Oops. Come on. There we go. Maybe vertically a little bit up, yeah, like that. Maybe a bit more. Yeah, that will do. And now I'm going to actually maybe I'm going to move it up. No, I can't. Okay, so I'm gonna scale it. So you know it's actually, you know what, I don't have to scale it. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna crop it, because if I crop it, yeah, I can crop it to make it a little bit more narrow. There we go. Something like this. So I'm not gonna lose, you know, those buses in the bottom, because I actually like those buses. Okay, maybe increase it in here and make it wider here. There we go. Okay, that'll do. Perfect. So I'm kind of happy with that. Also, I'm gonna fix a bit of noise, because I was shooting this at 400 ISO, I think, and oh no, 200. Oh, that's pretty low. But anyway, I'm going to sharpen it up a bit and apply some masking, same principle, press Alt and the black areas will not get sharpened, the white areas will get sharpened. So I'm going to increase the detail, so the sharpening will affect the larger areas, and sorry, there's the larger details. And I'm going to increase the luminance a bit, and yeah, maybe something like that. Okay, I think we're done. Maybe play a bit with colors, you know, increase the oranges and and the yellows and greens, maybe not, maybe greens, maybe drop some greens. Greens, yellows make it a bit warmer, and yeah, maybe I'll increase the blues a bit. Yeah, why not? Okay, that'll do. Yeah, drop the greens down. Okay. Thinking if the lights are too bright or not. Okay. All right. And once you're done, just click here on Save Images and choose your location. I already have a chosen location. And I will not change anything because I've already set it up, but I've increased the quality to maximum, and I chose the Pro for the RGB color and increased the resolution to 300 pixels per inch. And once you set it up, you just click Save. You don't have to change anything here, so it's gonna save with the same name as we already set up in Bridge. So nothing has to be changed in here. Over here you can choose either JPEG or TIFF, and if you choose TIFF, you might want to change this to 16 bits per channel. This is basically when you want to do some major editing in Photoshop, and yes, you can actually edit a group of photos in Photoshop in a movie mode. So if you want to do some major editing in Photoshop, you might want to go with TIFFs, but remember that TIFFs are pretty big, and I don't know, about 50-60 megabytes each. So if you're gonna be loading 460 megabytes to your Photoshop, that will seriously slow things down. So I suggest you do all the major editing you need to in Adobe Camera Raw. That's why I'm actually saving JPEGs. And I'm gonna click Save. Now, here you can see that the computer will start saving the files one by one, and once it's done, you can start working on your time lapse. I'm going to pause this video and wait for my files to be saved. And this is the end of part one of this tutorial, and I'll create a part two in which I'll show you how to assemble all those photos into a movie and make a time lapse in Photoshop. You can also use for this purpose Adobe After Effects. It is a bit different software. It's more towards movie making, and it gives you much more options. You know, a lot of people have Photoshop, not many people have Adobe After Effects, so I'm just going to show you guys how to do it in Adobe Photoshop. If there is a request for creating a tutorial for Adobe After Effects, I can do it as well. That's it for today, guys. Thank you for watching. You can find me on Google Plus under Pontryuri, and on Facebook also under Pontryuri. I'm running two websites, actually three websites, but two blogs. One of them is japaninphotography.com, and the other one is ryuri.com, and I'm giving you links to both websites in the video. Those websites are different. The Japanin Photography is about photographs from Japan almost exclusively. I also run workshops in Tokyo, photography workshops. So if you're visiting Tokyo or you live in Tokyo and you're interested in learning photography, I specialize in architecture, night photography, HDR, and also portraiture photography. So these are my things, and I also teach Photoshop, photo manipulation, and digital art. So have a look at my website at ryuri.com, and if you want just, you know, enjoy photos from Japan, then go to Japan time-lapse-in-photography.com, and you can find a lot of photos. I'm uploading their HD photos on a daily basis. If you have any suggestions for me for next Photoshop tutorials or any videos, let me know. I'm more than happy to create some custom videos for you guys. That's no problem. So if you have anything that you don't understand or you struggle with in Photoshop, just let me know and I can just create a movie. Thanks again, and I'll talk to you in part 2.